There was no such name as Creigiau in the beginning. It was known as Castle Hamlet. It was always traditionally part of the parish of Pentyrch, but it took its name from a farm through which the new railway in the late 1880s passed, the Barry Railway, which was built as an alternative to the Taff Vale Railway, which took the coal to Cardiff.
The route actually came through Creigiau, through Inverlissa, through Creigiau, and down to Tinnacaia Junction, where it met the branch from the Rumney Valley, which went across the large viaduct at Taff's Well.
But certainly when they built the station, they decided they would have to have a name for the station. And as it passed through a farm called Creigiau, they called it Creigiau. The term Creigiau is a rather posh interpretation of it, which came later.
There was a passenger service then opened from Barry to Pontypridd via this route, and as such people wanted to actually come and live here and work in Barry Docks or work on the railways. Lots of houses were then built. As people gravitated to the area, the quarry had opened, and that provided an income for people, and quite a lot of wealthy people actually came to live in Creigiau.
The village community grew up around the station, and in no time at all a church hall was built, which again helped the community to thrive. Then after the First World War, the golf club was formed.
Quite a number of people who were involved in the coal industry in Corriff were founder members there, and then there was a company called Beers in Corriff, no relation to Trevor Beer. He had quite a large business in Corriff, and they were some of the original members, along with Winnie Woods and Doris Chaston.
It was a matter of convenience for them, because they were mostly tradespeople, drapers and such like, who closed on Wednesday afternoons and were delighted to have this opportunity to come to a new club, put their own stamp on it and so forth. Even though it was a nine-hole course, they had professionals there, they had groundsmen there, one at a time probably, but certainly they were professionally looked after, and they had some leading golf figures there, of course. Kenyon was a professional. He won the Irish Open, I think it was twice. Then you had a man who won the Welsh Open. High standard golfers. After the Second World War, when I became more familiar with the golf club, and speaking to Brian Wood, God rest his soul, about it, he was able to remind me that his grandfather, Tom Evans, had been one of the founders actually, and of course he became a steward, I think, and his grandmother was a stewardess there. She kept a little shop nearby, which was frequented by golfers, so I think they did rather well out of it. Brian's mother, Winnie Wood, was secretary for many years, ladies secretary anyway, ladies captain too. Brian himself, I think, was the club champion in the early 1960s, probably about 1964.
It's always had a very good social side here, which is, I think, is quite different from a lot of clubs. When I first joined, I suppose the real characters were people like Charlie Patterson, Charlie Elliott, Dr. Young, Bruno Albertelli. They were all sort of in their 40s and 50s at the time. Charlie Patterson had won the club championship many times, and they always had a little clique that went out together. And of course, me being a young man, they looked like very old men to me, and I suppose now I have the same impression on the youngsters who come in.
It was a very good club socially. We had a number of very talented people, and we had concert parties. A lot of it was our own fun. We all took part.
Back in the 60s, You had some characters in the golf club, like the two Bill Morgans and Trevor Beer. And when I joined you, I think that the society had finished, but it was called the Knockers. The Knockers were there to knock the committee. And when you became a member, you knock the door in the thing, right, and they'd open the door. Are you a member? And you'd reply, you bet your sweet ass I am. And you were allowed in.
Well, for a lady captain, you have social nights that are either arranged by the men or the ladies during the year. At one time, before we moved into the new clubhouse, our big dances used to be in other places like the City Hall or somewhere like that. I think the year that I was captain, it was held in the City Hall. And it was more of a do.
In 1979, I became into captaincy, and after further discussions, Wingfield agreed to sell part of the present course, providing we gave up what was then the 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, and the first part of the 7th holes, and he would sell us the ground where the first development came about. Now, that new ground was in a terrible state. It was rutted, and we used to get a lot of people saying, oh, you know, when you open in the water safari park and what have you. So it took a great deal of faith and time.
In 1979, we bought the golf course from the Wingfield estate, including land to enable the course to be slightly restructured. So by 1980, the land was ours. By the time we got to 1983, it was clear, I think, to most of us, that the new course layout wasn't working particularly well. We'd gone from a small nine-hole course, to a large nine-hole course, with long walks between green and tee. And a few of us, on a SIGS trip, decided to come up with a new design for the hole's layout.
Well, I sat down and drew the course up that I thought would work here with the land that was possibly available. I used all of that those areas. Some of them we actually abandoned and gave back to the farmer. But we got other things for it, you know, which actually, to my mind, improved the layout.
Which was accepted by management. Howard Powell was the captain at the time. Colin Jenkins was the vice captain. And in 1983, we redeveloped the nine holes into a 14-hole complex. And in my year of captaincy, I opened the new layout, where we then started on what is now the 15th. We played four holes around to the clubhouse and another 14 back to the clubhouse. And that proved very successful, in as much as we were able to increase the membership from 275 to 375, which provided substantial extra funding. And I then negotiated with the Wingfield estate to buy an additional 22 acres of land, which now constitute 7, 8, 9, and 10, so that we were able to go to a full 18 holes. And that was developed in Cyril Baker's year in 1985 and opened by Dave Scard in 1986. And since then, we've been an 18-hole golf course. And that was very successful because we pushed the membership in terms of male membership from 375 to 450. And we're certainly another 100 on top of that now, I guess. But that gave us a very strong financial platform to develop funding for the new clubhouse, which was done in 1992-93.
In 1991, a meeting was held at Llanthrasant Leisure Centre to determine if it was that we were going to do something, how much money we should spend. Well attended, but by an overwhelming majority, it was decided, yes, the club could have permission to spend a certain amount of money, £360,000, on a particular build. Whether it would be refurbishment, whether it would be new build, would be debated later.
There were many disputes about it, because a lot of people wanted, not only some people want to stay where we are now, I'm afraid we are, you know, but a lot of people wanted to go to the Greenfield site, right, and which is down roughly where the Greenkeeper shed is at the moment, you know. But then there was other people in this meeting wanted to stay and renovate. But after Cook and Arkwright surveyed the old clubhouse, they said there's no way you could renovate. The foundations were too weak for a start. So this is when we had to build then, out there, all the Greenfield. Anyway, in the end, this site had the most votes, and that was it, really.
The facts speak for themselves. 88 people said here, 53 people said over there, and 12 abstentions. And so it was, we accepted the quote from Molem to redevelop here. When I assumed office of captaincy in the April of 1992, the club needed strong personalities to help get everything moving. I was extremely fortunate in having wise counsel, Doug Vaughan, Bob Wickman, a quantity surveyor who became chair of building. I had Howard Evans, chartered accountant, long-standing member of this golf club, past captain, as chairman of finance, and Cyril Baker, who also happened to be chairman of Greens, overseeing the development when Molem got involved.
Part of my year was the boys with the Mail on Sunday team. You know, we achieved the impossible, really. You know, we went to the Belfry to play in the quarterfinals and won, which meant then we were all off to Spain to play the semi-final and the final, and we all know the result.
The team, mainly that year, because it was quite strict, actually. You couldn't have, you had to have four players. It was a squad of six players. Four people played in the team. The team wasn't allowed to be changed around. The only way you could change the team was actually if someone was ill. The team that played as often as possible was myself, Craig, Matthew, and then Adam Richards. So we managed to get through all those events. Again, we had Mike Harmer came in on an odd occasion because invariably Craig, with international duty with Europeans and things, was, oh, it was off. But lucky enough, he was home for the British final, which was at the Belfry. We had a busload from the club came up to watch the final. Craig played, Matthew, and obviously myself, and then Adam. And then it brought us all down to Adam Richards. And he was all flat going down the last, so he was level going down the last. He stands there, he said a great tee shot, middle of the 18th fairway at the Belfry. Adam then proceeds to pull out, I believe it was a 3-wood or a 5-wood. One good swing, turned out to be sort of a top thin, which somehow pitched in the middle of the lake, three bounces later, hopped up the other side onto the bank by the green.
And it aquaplaned all over the pond up onto the front of the green. It was absolutely incredible.
Whereby Adam then proceeded to chip and putt, in all fairness to him, to win his match and to send us through to the final, which was then out in San Roque in the November. So we were there, myself, Mike Harmer, Adam Richards, Kevin Miller, Matthew. Myself, Matthew and Mike played really solidly, and we won 3-1 again in the final. So which was a great event. Matthew won 2-1. I remember him playing a fantastic shot into the 17th hole. Again, you know, his inspirational caddy, George Council, just told him to get on with it, to win comfortably. And we had to have big pictures outside the clubhouse with their mail on Sunday, big flag. Nice sort of picture frames, silver picture frames, with, you know, to commemorate the day.
And it's a really one of these competitions. You just read about other people winning. You don't expect to win it yourself. There's too many good people around. Back in 1993, Creigiau Golf Club's greens were called browns because we couldn't grow grass. For some unknown reason, the treatment that we'd been given by the STRI, who are a professional body, didn't work for us. And it had been tested and tried by my predecessor, Cyril Baker, for about 3 to 4 years, and we weren't getting anywhere. Because we had no base to our greens, we needed to build them up. So that was Rob's idea, and that's what we did. And we top dressed on a regular basis, once a month, and overseeded once a month for about 3 years. And that's when our greens took off.
Thank you. Well, it was where I spent my youth, really. I went there every day, rain or shine. Made good friends, both with the younger crowd and the older. Duncan Samuel, for example, I was very friendly with. And in fact, Matthew Jones and myself played table tennis with Duncan in the winter. So the friendship through golf carried on outside of golf. But it'll always be close to my heart because it's where I learned golf and spent nearly every day of my teenage years.
I think Creigiau Golf Club offers a lot of good experiences from when you're young to when you're growing up, because when you first arrive, the junior section make you feel so welcome that you just want to keep coming back every week. And then you go through playing in the junior teams and playing all the junior competitions to then going into playing the ladies or the men's events. And it's great because it just doesn't stop you from coming. It's so encouraging and you just want to come back and play golf all the time.
I joined from Cardiff Golf Club, where I'd been a member since 1969, but I've lived in the village since 72, and it was at a time when, having been a member of Creigiau 23, my son Philip, who was coming up to 14 or 15, said, "Dad, can I play golf?" And it seemed the logical thing to do to say, "Let's join Creigiau." And I have to say, it's probably one of the very best decisions I've ever made, because so much has happened as a result of being a member of this fine club.
There's a lot of people here who come up with a village attitude, so therefore you're welcome whenever you come here. And as a golfer, I couldn't see myself going anywhere else.
Certainly a club that has been exceedingly warm and welcoming of everyone who's ever been there.
I never dreamt, I've got to be honest, when I was a boy, that I'd ever be wealthy enough to join a golf club. I should point out that I wasn't a member in 1921. Well, the happiest years of my life, I should think, being a member there. It was a great little club to belong to.
I think it's the actual golf club. It's camaraderie. It's a home full of friends. Yeah.
There's one thing that Creigiau Golf Club has, and it is friendship. It just has an amazing amount of friendly people, and long live Creigiau Golf Club. It's been a dear friend to me.